Welcome to the Mediterranean Conference Center's theatre. To ensure that your short stay with us is a safe one, the management has introduced measures which would ensure a rapid evacuation of the theatre should this be required. In this respect, you are kindly being asked to note the colour-coded discs attached to the top of the seat back in front of you. This coloured disc matches a coloured plate posted above a particular emergency exit located within the theatre itself. This is the door you should use to exit, or as otherwise directed by the ushers in the event of an emergency. May we remind you all to remain calm and collected during the evacuation procedure.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to you. My name is Shahira Amin. I'm your moderator this morning. I'm an Egyptian journalist based in Cairo, an independent journalist. And for me, the topic here is very close to my heart because I grew up in Sri Lanka, Ghana, and Malaysia. My son lives in Belgium. And he's married to an Italian national. So this is a very personal issue, multiculturalism for me, and it's very close to my heart. I want to welcome you to the plenary debate on populations on the move, leveraging new opportunities for dialogue. Against the backdrop of a refugee crisis and with an increasing number of people on the move across the region, there are many, many challenges, but there are also strategic opportunities for renewed partnership and intercultural dialogue. The first part of this morning's debate will focus on the potential for interaction between refugee, migrant, and diaspora communities on the one hand, and the host communities on the other. Without further ado, let me introduce our distinguished panelists. Please join me in welcoming His Excellency Mr. Zlatko Lagumdzija. He is the former Prime Minister of Bosnia and Herzegovina and founder of the Shared Societies and Values Sarajevo Foundation. He's also World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid member. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Take your seat.
Thank you.
Khalid Shawi, he's chair of the Cultural Committee for the Union for Mediterranean Parliamentary Assembly and also on the Foreign Affairs Committee of the Italian Chamber of Deputies. Morning, Khalid.
Morning.
Imatur Faus is Director of French Language and Linguistic Diversity at the International Organization for the Francophonie. Tarek El Saleh, a serial entrepreneur, founder and programs director of Capoeira. Capoeira for Refugees. I think a lot of people here know him. Hi. Last but certainly not least, I'd like to welcome Rehab Mejri, is dialogue leader, Young Arab Voices. She's taken part in several debates, several debate tournaments, and was the winner of the Debating Boxing Days organization in 2013. Welcome, Rahab. I'd like to welcome you all, and I'll start with a question for you, sir, former Prime Minister of Bosnia and Herzegovina, Mr. Lagumdzija. What can you tell us, sir, about the role of political leadership in advocating for positive policies for shared society against the backdrop of certain political and media narratives advocating for just the opposite.
Well, the microphone works, right? First, thank you very much, and I want to welcome, all of you, and I'm very glad I started this session with my dear friend from Young Arab Voices. She's framing this panel from another side. We were in Jordan 9 months ago, where I met an extraordinary group of young people from 7 countries from Arab world, from Tunisia, Morocco, Algeria, Egypt, Jordan, Palestine, and Lebanon. And I shared my thoughts with them about the role of leadership and about the necessity to look in a world as a world that has to be different than the world today. I just, as a part of my visit, I went to Zaatari, camp that holds or hosts about 80,000 at the time when I was there, 80,000 refugees, mostly from Syria. And it reminded me a lot of what was happening in my own country not billion years ago. But what I witnessed over there, as a matter of fact, the gentleman, Colonel Abdurrahman, who was running the camp as organizing everything, I knew him from Bosnia 20 years ago. What I'm trying to say is that it is very important to understand that what is happening today in this part of the world around Syria and Middle East, that is something that I saw was happening to me in the very middle of the Europe back 25 years ago. What is happening today is something that may happen to everyone everywhere. And that's the reason why it is very important that Anna Lindh Foundation is actually creating the environment, positive atmosphere, energizing all of us in here to see how we can use our own small leadership capacities in order to make the only one leadership capacity, which is the big one, if we work together, if we share the same beliefs, same values, especially the values of better world of tomorrow. As a Club de Madrid member, I'm very much involved in a project which is called Share Society. And that's the reason why I created foundation in my own home city, together with Club de Madrid, to promote the idea of shared society, society in which people are united in their differences, in which all of us are sharing the goal to live together, not one by another, but together, one with each other, with our own identities, multiple identities, because if we don't find a way to do so, the world is going to be going in the wrong direction. But what we have to understand, that, and that's what I hope that we will all share, if we want to have a better future, we are not supposed to be predicting it. We are supposed to be trying to create it along the values that we share. And that's why it is so important to understand that in today's world, which is kind of globally paradoxical, today we have 4 times bigger economic power than when Berlin Wall fell down. Technology speaking, we are 3 times more powerful. Knowledge-wise, we have 2 more times knowledge than all knowledge created since the Stone Age to Berlin Wall fell down. But at the same time, we have 2 times more refugees than we had at that time. We have another 60 walls inside or in between 40 countries in the world. Today, when democracy and people who are living in democracy is 2 times bigger in the amount of the citizens than it was when Berlin Wall fell down, we would expect that today we live in much better world, but we still do not. And that's the reason why I hope that around the values that we share, about the values that Anna Lindh was about, not only foundation, but I knew Anna Lindh personally, around the values that Anna Lindh lived for, the world can be different. And no one can do it alone. And that's the reason why I thank you very much for this opportunity. And I want to thank you again for meeting extraordinary young Arab voices of today that are going to be louder tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lagumtia. And for those of you who don't know, the Zaatari camp is in Jordan, and it's one of the biggest refugee camps housing, as Mr. Lagumtia said, 8,000?
80,000.
80,000
people. The biggest camp in the world, besides the one in Somalia, which has about 200,000. But the biggest camp in Middle East, with 25,000 kids going into schools, with over one-third of population being underaged, with 500 kids going in kindergarten. This is a big city, city of people who only want one thing. They want to go back home. And that's what we have to make everyone being at home in their homes, or when they come, someone to be at home as well, not in Zaatari.
And they've escaped the conflict in Syria, of course, so it's not possible for them to go home. Well, thank you for that. Let me turn to you, Khaled. And Italy, of course, is on the front line of issues on refugees and migration. What are some of the challenges and the opportunities? And if you can share with us some good practices for migrant host community relations.
Yeah, first of all, good morning. Sabah al khair. Mahaba, and thank you very much for your invitation. I'm really happy to be here for one important point. We finally speak on people on move and not about migration crisis. I think the words are very important today, and if you want to be a good example on how we can make an effective counter-narrative on these issues, we must start from the words. And when we speak, when you're speaking this morning about people on move, about 60 million of people moving around the world, about the history of humanity, and not only the last 5 or 6 or 10 years, we make, I think, a good job for create a new counter-narrative, in particular against media propaganda and also fighting many extremist groups in Europe today, and they maybe work just for few votes more, and not think we are speaking about human being. We are speaking about families. We are speaking about people like us. And this is, I think, a very important message from Annalyn Foundation and from this this floor. About Italy, you know, Italy is a Mediterranean country, like Malta, like all our counties. But really, we discovered in the last years an extraordinary humanity from Italian population. You know Lampedusa. Lampedusa today is one of the most important islands, just because the Lampedusa people opened their doors, their hearts, to all people from Africa, from Syria, and also from Asia. I can tell you many best practices, but I will just tell you about a small municipality, the municipality of Ferriace. And the mayor of Ferriace now, with just 2,000 inhabitants, is one of 50 international most popular people by Fortune magazine. Because just before 10 years, this small city risked to close because all people go out to other cities. And in till 1998, Ajaccio has been slowly doing to population loss. People left the small municipalities, and he opened his municipality to refugees with a good integration project for them. Now Ajaccio lives with more than 10,000 people, and with new jobs possibility for people. The same thing is Milan, for example. Milan, you know, is in north of Italy, and she's just a transit city to other European countries. But the mayor of Milan, Pisapia, opened many possibilities for asylum seekers to do some of voluntary works in public gardens, and also in hospitals. And today, the image of refugees in public opinion is changing very fast. This because we have a very smart local administrator, but also we have good NGOs working together with the local communities also and with the religious community in Italy. But it's not often today, because when we have a good experience, start in local cities with small NGOs, but in the same time, unfortunately, the political debate, the European political debate, is incredible for me, because I think it's the first time we have a big action against Daesh, military battle against terrorism in Syria, in Iraq, but at the same time we haven't any international strategy for the victims of this terrorism and the victims of our political battles. This represents, I think, a big problem about our currency, what we can do, and how we can be really have with the credibility when we speak about democracy, when we speak about freedom with the Mediterranean population, if we don't represent an example about how we can be really coherent with our values. This is the big problem for us, and also for me when I trip around the Mediterranean and I speak with my friends, my sisters, brothers from all Mediterranean countries, and maybe we want to work together. We discuss together about democracy, about human rights, and how we can strengthen a new democratic system. But at the same time, today Europe, unfortunately, at European level, we don't represent this model of solidarity between countries. For example, you know, Hungary today refused to welcome just 1,200 people for 1 year. In the same time, in Sicily, we received 6,000 in 1 day in Lampedusa. This is the description of Europe today. We have a good example in Sweden, in Germany, and many other countries, but we cannot accept that situation in few European countries. So we have to improve our counter-narrative with social media, to work with NGOs like you, with young people, but in the same time, we have to push for a new politics in our counties. And for this, I think the cooperation between small politicians like me and like other friends and a foundation like Annalind and all the NGOs is the unique solution for change the politics in Europe and the Mediterranean.
Wonderful, thank you very much. But often we focus too much on the problem itself without looking at the root causes. And Imma, if I can turn to you and ask you about the Organization for the Francophonie and how it tackles the root causes of migration. Thank
you. Oui, bonjour, alors tout d'abord je voudrais...
Hello. First of all, I'd like to thank the Annalind Foundation for inviting the International Organization for Francophonie to participate in this debate, a debate in which it has its full place. First of all, I'd like to remind you that our organization is made up of 80 states and governments who are members, 30 of which are African, and 17 member states from the EU. And there are 26 states who are members both of the International Organization for Francophonie and members of the Annalind Foundation. Of course, like the Annalind Foundation, the International Organization for Francophonie gathers countries from exit countries or departure countries, but transit countries and host countries of migrants and refugees. This shows you how much this issue of immigration is of interest to us, especially it called on the attention of the ministers of Francophonie that who adopted during their latest or last meeting in December 2015 in Yerevan, Armenia. They adopted a resolution on refugees and migrants in which they state the need to promote the sustainable development in the countries of origin and transit countries in order to deal with the deep sources or in-depth sources origins of irregular immigration. Our Secretary General had participated here exactly in La Valette on the summit on migration that you might recall. It was in November 2015. And there had been, we adopted an action plan during the summit, an action plan in which the first priority had been, was, and I'm quoting here, the fight against the deep reasons or causes for irregular migration of people or displaced persons. And our Secretary General had also participated in this high-level debate of the UN General Assembly on the management of mass displacements of refugees and migrants. It was on the 19th September, and these are the terms in which she raised the question that we're dealing with today. And if instead of raising walls and putting up barbed wire, she's referring here to the camps, so instead of raising walls and barbed wire, if we invested in human development and economic and sustainable economic development, and exactly investing in economic and human sustainable development, this is what the International Organization for Francophonie deals with or does. And in fact, it's the theme of our next summit, which will be held in Madagascar in November of this year. Shared growth and development, responsible development. So in a few words, how we work or act regarding these deep causes, of course, it's obvious that human development is not possible without political stability. And in this field, the IAF has been carrying out for many years prevention actions and for conflict and crisis resolution, and also actions for reinforcement of democracy and reinforcement or strengthening of institutions and a state of law, and also awareness actions and education on rights and freedoms. This was covered very much yesterday here, and it's something very, very important. Francophonie is also given itself over 2 years, past 2 years, an economic strategy, and in this framework, through our program for the promotion of women and youth entrepreneurship, we have put in place, specifically in 12 Africa, sub-Saharan African countries, who are in fact the most affected by mass exodus, we have put in place incubators to reinforce the capacities of the small and very small and micro enterprises and businesses, and who we know are the engines for growth, the motors for employment and growth. And also through our Institute for Sustainable Development based in Quebec, we also support the most vulnerable countries of the Francophone area so that they can adapt to the devastating effects of climate change. And of course, we also act, and it's our core business in the fields of education and training within the line for the World Agenda for Education 2030. And we act through programs such as Elan, which is school and national language program. It's a program that is mostly implemented in Africa and valorizes the mother tongue of the children by introducing it in their first education, or also programs such as IFADEM, which is a Francophone initiative for the remote training of school teachers, which builds and strengthens the capacities of teachers, of course, without forgetting all our action in the field of culture to promote cultural diversity, intercultural dialogue. I'll go back to it if I have time later. So, well, of course, with the support to creators, writers, movie directors, to artists of all kinds, and to facilitate their circulation and mobility of these artists. And also for the countries, of course, we work mostly in support of countries. We help them to build the real policies, cultural policies, in line with the UNESCO agreement on the protection and promotion of diversity of cultural expressions. This is more or less very quickly summarized how we act on the deep, in-depth causes of immigration or migration. And we wish to work in complementarity, in complement with you, while taking into account in a spirit of partnership, while taking into account especially of the needs of the local populations, and also maybe to start the debate, maybe if it's a field where we don't intervene or interact directly, I think we should all together contribute to the construction in the short term and even at the longer term of a migratory policy, an international migratory policy, under the auspices of cooperation and concertation with each other, especially as a sign of an exchange, of a win-win exchange. Thank you. Thank you, Ima.
They're often forced to flee conflict-ridden areas, and they're prepared to risk their lives making this very dangerous journey across the Mediterranean to get to what they think is the El Dorado. Now, you've lived and worked with refugees and, you know, in Jordan and in Syria. I want you to share with us some of the experiences of the refugees.
Okay. I mean, I have many stories about people fleeing their homes. One particular I have in mind is someone called Ahmed. He's one of our students in Azraq refugee camp, which is also in Jordan, in the middle of the desert. In my opinion, Zatri refugee camp is a bit like Tokyo against Azraq camp, because it's one of the most soulless places I ever been. So Ahmed, he fled Aleppo after his house was bombed and destroyed, traveled and roaming around for over 3 months, losing, you know, all his money to bribes, running out of food and water, finally managed after 3 months then coming to Jordan, to the border, like you said, going into the El Dorado, finally I'm there. So first thing what happened, he was like beating down, you know, with his head in the sand with a boot, and they broke his nose, still a bit like this. And Ahmed is 16 years old. So now he's in Azraq refugee camp, which, you know, Syrian refugees aren't allowed to work. So you just see lots of male hanging around, kicking up the desert sand. Women after 13, 14 years, you don't really see them as part of the camp because they're not allowed of their shelters. Many marry before the age of 15. So imagine Ahmed coming into this refugee camp, and there's zero opportunities. There's nothing, literally nothing to do. The first of all, when I met him, the first thing what he wanted, just want to go back to Syria and joining the fight. I think we all would probably have that in mind as well. And so to tweak the story a little bit positive as well, Ahmed is one of our best students. He's now walking on his hands, you know, playing the instruments. Again, they have nothing to do. If you give them an instrument, next week they play better than you. He wants to be a trainer now. For the future, training his friends and his, you know, parents as well. You know, this is like one of those stories of one number in those many thousands, millions of refugees. I can tell more, but this is like you asked me like one of those stories, for example. Yeah.
I'm very familiar with this because I actually come from a country, Egypt, where African refugees face a lot of discrimination. They're not allowed to work, they can't send their children to school, and so a lot of them choose to cross the border into Israel and very often get shot in doing that. So we don't want to paint a gloomy picture, but have you come across any like success stories that you can share with us?
Okay, I mean,
brighter side of things.
There are two sides, of course. Let's say the project itself, Capoeira, you know, exists as live music, sport, play. The story of Capoeira opens the minds to new cultures as well, because Capoeira came from the struggle, from the oppressed. It's the sport of the oppressed, from African slaves. The stories of Capoeira reflecting this as well. The songs, they are talking about violence, about gender, and so forth. Which then also opens up their minds of our students. So Capoeira itself is the highlight of the month for many, many, many children. So you can see if we would start now playing music together, doing exercise together, having sport, you know, doing sport together, the absence of play, so what is the opposite of play? It's depression. It unites people, it brings people together, and especially Capoeira, it allows to release your anger and frustration in a healthy way as well. If we both play now Capoeira and I kick you, it's my fault. Yeah, in Capoeira there's no winners, no losers. If I make my jumps and so on, it's not a nice game, you have to play together. And you can see in those kids, they're lighting up, they're creating friendship, they're starting to trust each other. We're speaking also a lot about education and so forth. We're picking up children who went through immense trauma. You can't put them in a school. They have, like many have an attention span of half a second. So you have to entertain them, you have to really open them up and really prepare them slowly. How is it again to be part of a society? That's let's say the positive side of what we're doing, which is difficult. No, Capoeira is great for me personally. I mean, it's sport, music, live music. There's many good projects as well who have that, what people desire, what is essential for us to feel happy. But the downside of everything is to organize it, the programming, to work in that, countries, to get access. Is it very frustrating for me to hear a lot, or to also to see what is really going on in the camp? How is it to organize a program? How long it takes actually to go there and to be there? Over the years, we trained like 60,000 children and so forth in Syria, Palestine, Jordan, and so forth. But I think the real success was just to train local trainers who already went on to train the next generation of trainers, who are now training the next generation. That wouldn't have been possible if we just work with our partners, which I don't think they're even partners. We're working with Save the Children, with UNICEF, with the, with different larger NGOs. But working with those organizations is incredible, time-consuming, administrative, frustrating. And for me, it's not a surprise that there is Trump, Brexit, yeah? It's an uprising against the establishment. And who is this establishment? People are frustrating. I think we have to change our systems and not expect that we want to support the people on the ground, that they, people coming to the ground, coming to me and applying for a grant which has like a ridiculous amount of paperwork and lock frames and so forth. We never reach the people on the ground who are actually doing the work, who are good with kids and can write an application. That's the downside of the work.
So, Tariq, making a difference with Capoeira. And I stop at one word he said, building trust, which of course is crucial. I'll turn to you now, Rehab, and Rehab is from Tunisia. You are Tunisian, and I would like to hear from you how young Tunisians feel about the issue of migration.
First of all, I'd like to start by greeting you all and saying how much I'm honored and humbled to be among such inspiring people. I'd like to start by stressing how much Tunisia is of crucial importance to the Euro-Mediterranean area. Tunisia is very close to the southern European Mediterranean countries. We've shared histories, we've shared heritage, we share culture. But it is also of crucial importance because it has become a point of departure and transit for a lot of immigrants, illegal immigrants, not only from Tunisia, but also from the Maghreb countries and from the sub-Saharan Africa. They come to Tunisia because it's very close there.
And, now, Tunisia, and vice versa, because vice you've versa. Had an enormous number of refugees also fleeing Tunisia.
To Tunisia.
And from Tunisia as well. They've taken the risk for a better life in Europe, what they think is a better life.
Yes, actually there's a huge section of Tunisian youth before the revolution and after the revolution who really thought that their only hope is to go and join Europe. They thought it's a safe haven. They thought that is the best solution for them and it is a kind of utopia. Although they disregarded the risks they are taking, how much it is very hard to start anew, to start their lives from scratch, to go there illegally, to have no job, no secure home, no shelter. I think that we should also look at why Tunisian youth are trying to go there. I want to start by giving an experience of a man that I met yesterday, actually, here in Malta. My friends and I were grabbing dinner, and we stopped at a very small restaurant in the streets, and we were speaking Tunisian. And then the guy was actually the man from Tunisia, and he said, "Yay, I'm from there, and welcome here," and also. We started to talk with him and to ask why is he here and how he has come here. Actually, years ago, he was an illegal immigrant. He fled from Tunisia to Europe. He stayed a couple of years illegally roaming around Europe. And then he came to Malta and fixed his situation and started a business here. We asked him, what pushed you to go to Europe? This man said that he had just once a quarrel with a man and they went to the police station and he started to have a bad police record. And in Tunisia, we ask people when they're looking for jobs to bring their police record. And if they have a tarnished police record, they will have difficulties getting a job. So he found himself jobless with no income and the world just blackened in his eyes. So he fled to Europe. I think we really should see why Tunisian youth, a huge sector of Tunisian youth, even after the revolution, fled to Europe. Many, about thousands of Tunisians, right in 3 months after the revolution, because of the security issues right after the revolution, they fled to Europe. And more than half of them died. More than half of them drowned in the sea. Their bodies are never found. So we need to look for the root issues that push Tunisian youth to flee their country. I think we should, this multiculturalist dialogue between Europe and the MENA region, and Tunisia in particular, will help these youth realize that they can have their own opportunity in their own homes. They need to find an outlet for their own energy. So I think that Tunisian youth are running away from their country just because they think they do not have much opportunity, and they do not have many opportunities to unleash their own capacities.
Which is the same in all other countries.
Absolutely.
It's lack of opportunities, it's desperation, it's frustration, even after the revolution,
yes.
Because of the unmet expectations, I would say.
Yes, the revolution has been now, it has been 5 years since the revolution. And we still have a very fragile economy. We still have a very fragile security issues. We have the borders with Libya and the borders with Algeria are sometimes infiltrated by some extremist groups. We had some terrorist attacks in Tunisia, sorry. So the situation.
Are there any initiatives on the ground to raise awareness about the issue of migration in Tunisia?
Yes, absolutely. There have been many initiatives that are trying to raise awareness among youth. And also from the government, right after the revolution, there has become a state member who is allocated the responsibility of migration and illegal migration. He started talking to, going to the ground, talking to the families of those sons or daughters went and flee their country. There are also youth organizations and NGOs and small groups that are starting to go from cafe to cafe, from rural cafes, from home to home, especially in the cities where a lot of the coastal cities where they're the point of departure to Europe. There are a lot of a concentration of NGOs there who are trying to raise awareness among youth about the risks that, that they are taking. So thankfully, after the revolution, there is more attention allocated to this issue, but not enough, I would say.
But I would say that the picture of this little Syrian boy lying on the shore changed a lot of perceptions on both sides of the Mediterranean True. About the issue of migration. Absolutely. It was an alarm bell, right?
It was an alarm bell not only for the countries that have their own inhabitants going to Europe, but also to European countries to start a dialogue between each other. I think that is what we need right now.
Thank you very much, Raheb. We've heard from our five panelists here. Before we take some questions from the floor and comments, maybe you would like to comment about some interesting point that another panelist raised. We had lots of interesting points like political will, high-level commitment to tackle the refugee crisis, using social media to raise awareness, capoeira, building trust and confidence, and Libre Ensemble, or Vivre Ensemble, that initiative from the Organization of Francophonie. So, sir, would you like to comment on any of this?
Well, two short points. First one, when Khalid mentioned Lampedusa, we all know Lampedusa as Ireland, but I would recall, I mean, before Lampedusa became known because of refugees, Lampedusa, Giuseppe di Lampedusa made one famous Italian author, had one of the most famous known book, El Gattopardo, that is talking about transition in Garibaldi time in Italy. And Khaled knows that very well, that's why he's smiling. I mean, there's famous line when Tancredi is saying to his uncle, actually the philosophy of that time and of today's time, which I call Lampedusa effect in Gattopardo way, everything has to change so everything can stay the same. So we have to do everything. We have to change everything if we want to stay in peaceful and hopeful European Union and Mediterranean in particular. So everything has to change. That's one point. The second point is about double standards that we were witnessing. And I mean, Rehab was saying about it as well as Khalid and Tarek especially. In Jordan, there's about 9.5 million people, out of which 1.5 million are refugees. People almost forgot that there are 2 million Palestinians who are basically refugees in Jordan. Yes. So you see, you have 3.5 million people in a country of 9.5 million people. More than one third of the country are refugees. Can you imagine that Europe today gets hit by 150 million refugees? Can you imagine that when 100,000 people hit Europe, everything became CNNable, and everyone started caring about it. European Union is about 500 times more powerful economically than Jordan. But at the same time, we see that, and we have to think about getting rid out of double standards. We have to understand that we are living in one so connected world that if we forget about the values that European Union is about, because of so-called realpolitik, then there will be no Europe. And Hungarians are maybe the best example, because you see, back in 56, when Russians invaded Hungary, hundreds of thousands of Hungarians flooded over to get shelter in Yugoslavia and Austria. And they settled in few months all over the world. And today, they're reluctant about few hundreds, thousands of refugees. We have to think in a ways that the values that we are talking about, the values that we are thinking about, are the values that we are really doing, and that our beliefs actually are behind everything. Because selfish interests cannot be way forward. Only common values can unite us in direction of changing the world. And I mean, that's
so
what
you're saying is about. Focus on the commonalities rather than the differences. I think I'll take some questions and comments now from the floor, give our audience a chance to take part in this conversation. Is there a microphone going round? Okay. So please introduce yourself and keep your comment brief so we give them a chance to respond. Thank you.
Yes. It's working?
Yes.
It's
yes.
A simple question. It's in front of this tragic situation well described now about the refugees, one element we try to introduce as the Italian Network for Euro-Mediterranean Dialogue. We had a seminar September 8th in front of the Annalyn Advisory Committee, was the element of identity. So to what extent this keyword, respect for an evaluation for collective identity, and I would say identities in the plural, could help the discourse of facing racism, intolerance, and also the proselytism of radical movement towards terrorism. If all the elements of our roots, our origins of group identity, which anthropologically is the basis of any human being living together, can help to face these rhetorics. Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to answer that? Khaled.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think when we speak about inclusion, about welcoming, about dialogue, we cannot delete differences. And we cannot delete also why today not racist or radicals, radical political groups are against migration, but unfortunately we observing a growth of fear into our societies, in public opinions, in Europe in particular. Why? Because, you know, in last times we had also economic crisis, terrorist attacks, and more incomprehension between new Europeans and new Europeans. Because few European governments in last decades, didn't work in a good way on social inclusion and also on how we can manage a new intercultural society with also a new plural identity in our European countries. For this, I agree with the Italian friends that we have to open a real debate about the issue of identity, for just listen also the worries from our societies, not only in the north side of Mediterranean, but also in the south side, because many people confuse today the when we speak about integration, about inclusion, maybe they understand we speak about assimilation, okay? I think Annalyn and this and we together we have to focus more on this issue of identity or identities and how we can find common values into our different histories. I think we have the best example in Bosnia, Herzegovina, Albania, for example, Turkey, Morocco, Tunisia, Italy, Malta. And for this, we cannot speak only about our heritage, but we have to think together, what about our future? And we are the same thing, but in the same time, we have to protect our differences in this dialogue way.
I will share with you a story about identity, but first, Mr. Lagomgia would like to.
I think the share. Issue of identity is strongly connected with the keyword dignity. And the dignity is actually what is below and behind every oppression and every injustice today. When we tackle someone's dignity, we're actually tackling identities that you may have. In today's world, where you have about 9,800 different nations, when people speak about 7,000 different languages, when you have some people say 19 big religions and a few hundred religious groups, we don't know, is it 193 or 196 countries in the UN? I mean, what identities we are talking about? So we have to talk about multiple identities that people, and European identity or Mediterranean identity or my city's identity. This is something which we have to accept, that in way to protect your identity, you don't protect your identity. The way to protect your own identity is to protect every other people to have its own identity and have it with dignity. That's the way how you are protecting your own identity, by fighting for others' rights. Or is every religion golden rule says, don't do to others what you don't want to do be done to yourself. So that's, we have go back to the very simple principle. We have to do to others only what we want them to do to ourselves. Today's world is not a good example of how we behave.
We spent all summer.
I think that's the best quote of the day, wouldn't you agree? Protecting your identity is really about protecting the identity of others. So this very quick story about my son moving to Belgium, and he was totally westernized, had studied at the American university, married this foreign girl, and moved to Belgium. And I went to visit him, and he had grown a beard, was going to the mosque regularly, and would only go to places where there were Arab communities. Now, I was totally shocked and a bit scared, frankly. I even told his wife, perhaps it would be a good idea for you to come back home. Now, 3.5 years later, he's much, much better integrated into the society, has started to speak a bit of Flemish, has a lot of friends, got a promotion at work, and he's shaved the beard and is the son that I know. You know, he's back to normal, actually. But I think it was an attempt to reassert his Arab-Muslim identity, and that is what happens when you first move and feel out of place and not fitting in. I think it's a very common problem. Let's take two more questions, sir. Okay, the lady at the
front. My name is Lisa Limata. I'm a Finnish journalist. I'm based in Rome, and I have been following both immigrant questions for decades. I think the first case in Italy was in 86 in front of Calabria. And I also have been following a lot of about what happens in Muslim communities. So I want to talk about two things. I think the cutting of welfare societies is a very heavy question we should somehow consider here. For example, in Nordic countries today, we have the Finns and Swedes who are really part of fascist movements. And they are, because they are confused, they think that it's the immigrants who are taking something away from them. And they don't see that there is this neoliberal politics who is really creating a very important problems to the European societies. This is one question. Second is that there is a heavy movement of importation of very radical Islamic ideas in Europe. I know, Zlatko, you certainly know what happens in Bosnia, in Kosovo, and Albania. And this is also in other societies. I know that this kind of things ever will come in a paper or Anna Lindh Foundation, but I think we must be aware, because these radical Islamic ideas, they augment the fear of European population, and it's also a menace inside of Muslim communities in Europe. So I think these are two questions. Probably they will not put in any paper, but we must consider them, because otherwise we have no realistic picture of the whole thing.
Thank you. So who would like to answer the question on exporting radical ideas to Europe?
Since I was just very quickly, since you mentioned me, I mean, in your, I agree that that's a key issue, but I just want to underline that radicalism is something that should not be denominated to any group or any ethnic group or any religion. Because as far as I'm concerned, I said it a long time ago, I mean, after September 11 in UN General Assembly, that Radovan Karadzic and Bin Laden are actually two sides of the same coin. Like Jihad John and Breivik, who killed so many people in Norway, are the same radical elements and the same people coming from the same camp. And we have to fight against radicalism, preventing violent extremism, and the way to do it is to head into the roots of it, and the roots of it is actually the dignity of the people who are easily manipulated, and the healing thing for it is something which we called shared society. So shared society in which we respect each other is the best prevention for any radicalism, is it in my country, which I witnessed very well, or in any other part of the world.
Thank you very much. Go ahead.
I just want to add another point about the importation of radical ideas. I would rather say not importation, but actually that person did not take radicalism from his country and took it all the way to Europe. But I guess living there, totally not integrated in society, that person couldn't fit within the society or the environment that he or she is living there. I think that creates pent-up frustration that might lead that person into radicalization, either right-wing or extremists or any kind of radicalization. But I would not say importing the ideas.
Because a lot of the terrorist attacks were in fact carried out by second and third generation immigrants. So I hope that satisfies you. The first question, would someone like to answer the first part of the question?
No, I want just add a few words about the real problem of radicalization in Europe countries in particular. I think we have certainly social causes and economic causes, but also we have a religious problem into some communities, a responsibility of, for example, religious leader today to be clear against impossibility to utilize violence in religious discussion, for example, or also to give more visibility to some good experiences of minorities in the Muslim world. It's not easy today, in particular for young people in the Europe, to find a good representatives in a few counties. It's not a problem, I think, in my opinion, but we cannot open now a debate about this. But we have a big problems into Muslim world today, and I founded in 2001 the Italian Young Muslims Organizations. I'm proud to be Italian, European, Muslim, and Moroccan. But in the same time, I know very well we have to open a big debate between young people, not only between Muslim leaders, about how we understand when we speak about Muslim lifestyle, for example. Is it possible to be European and Muslim in the same time? And when we speak about these issues today, about the identity, about the multiple identities, it's very difficult to discuss this in the same time with models of secularism in Europe don't accept the possibility to have a specific also way to be citizen with your part of religious identity, for example. Yes. We spent many times the summer speaking about Burkini as the big enemy of a European identity. I think it's not possible. It's maybe one of points that we can discuss, discover differences, but we cannot spend 3 months of in all our newspapers, television, etc., speaking only about this point without speaking in general about why many girls today return to Muslim appearance, and why many people, many young people today try to rebuild their dignity only with the religious perspective, not only religious, only with radical perspective to be Muslim. This is just a few points. I know it's not easy to speak about this here, but I also invite the Annalyn Foundation to open a specific debate about the religious identity today, and also to discover there is a common action between European and Muslim young today in the term to discover their religious identity, but in a modern way. Thank you.
Wonderful. We'll take one last question before we move to the second part of the debate. Perhaps the lady in front, yes.
Merci.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the Bosnian Vice President for the crystal clear debates. Bosnia has witnessed a situation after Bosnia. We had Algeria, my country. So we have a huge experience, a wealth of experience in terms of radicalization and de-radicalization. I can assure you that de-radicalization is not a theory that is discussed. It is the families of the victims themselves that who said, stop, our children died, and we do not want that violence affect everybody. It was primarily, therefore, a cry from these people who were generous even in their pain. They were dignified. So the authorities was obliged to accommodate and to meet these demands, the requests. And this is the way, this is how we reduce the cycle of violence. People sat around a table and discussed, and Algeria went out of the cycle of violence. I didn't want some semantic mistake. I would like to say that the Annalid Foundation is the only space where this dialogue can take place and is really, and with which we really imbued. I do not want that these misperceptions and misinterpretation, that is to say that extremism, Muslim extremism, has been imported. Europe doesn't need to have extremism imported. The whole history of Europe has been crossed by extremism, and we know that. So we are at the southern shore of the Mediterranean, and we are scared. We are really scared because we have the NATO in front of us. We are vulnerable and fragile young countries, and now there is a release of hatred, of hateful words. Do I need to justify myself when there is an attack happening in Italy or France? Do I have to justify myself as a Muslim? No, I don't think so. So those misperceptions, those amalgams, are very dangerous, and we see that there is a release of hatred. We talk about wires, about walls, people talking about re-migration. People say that the migrants should be taken back home. So this is fascism. We're almost in the 30s. Do you realize how much stereotypes we have? We have been the first ones that suffered from terrorism. Those deaths, additions of deaths. You see that the Muslim people that have been killed by these so-called Muslims, can you imagine the high number of deaths? So we have always been stigmatized as Muslims. This is why we would ask the members of Annalise to take care of terminology. There is no more violent reaction than the other. There are only policies that use and utilize religion, and this is what we see everywhere.
Radicalism is not associated with a certain group or ideology. Well, I think we can now wrap up the first part of our debate. Okay, one last one here.
Thank you very much. My name is Caroline Robertson von Jota. I am the head of the German network. I'm a sociologist at Karlsruhe Institute for Technology. And as you know, in Germany, we have had a tremendous number of refugees. We had 2,000 even at our campus. And what we are now, I just wanted to say something before I then ask or make a comment on what I think we should be doing as Annalind. We are seeing, and just saying what also you have already been saying, we have seen the reactiveness of radicalization. We have a huge welcome culture. a huge number of honorary workers across Germany, but at the same time, across Europe, but also in Germany, we are seeing that the right-wing politics is increasing, that the polarization of societies is increasing instead of shared societies, instead of shared identities. So I think one of the questions that we have to also address, especially with the Annalind society being north and south and having such an enormous potential of practical experience, also of theoretical backgrounds, of political backgrounds, and of economic backgrounds, I think we have to ask ourselves, how can we look at the radicalization question and be more clear also about what we do north and south together at the local levels? Just one very quick example. You also mentioned it. We see many, many refugees coming to Europe with very completely illusionary expectations, which are very quickly disappointed. They are taking risks, others are making money with the trafficking, and I think it is a question which we as Annalind should look at. We used to talk about brain drain. It's not a word we use at the moment, but we are taking very capable young people with illusionary expectations of how quick they can be integrated into workforces in the north, and we are taking them away from the local situations, especially also we have many coming from Black Africa, where they are not able to grow up the industries there. So I think what we've been talking about in this wonderful meeting, including learning, including media, including cities, and including entrepreneurship, how can we get together as North and South and have partnerships to look also at the local and not just at the international? I think that would be extremely important. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those insightful comments. And I'm afraid that our time is up and we have to end this now. So very quickly to sum up, I think the best prevention here, the ideas that came from this debate, is better integration, more equal opportunities, and most of all, above all, protecting the dignity of the migrants or of others in general, but also opening up the space for debate. I'd like to thank our panelists. Please give them a big hand. It was a real learning experience. Thank you very much. And I will invite Miss Elizabeth Gigou, the president of the Annalind Foundation, to share her reflections on what we heard this morning. So thank you very much from me. Would you like to come to the podium? Madame Elizabeth, thank you very much. It was wonderful.
Bon, chers amis, my dear friends, let me tell you that each time we meet, I go back with a lot of vitality, because this is due to first here in Malta to the good warm welcome extended to us.
Authorities, I think that Malta embodies the spirit of our foundation, in fact, because maybe this country is really an excellent example of what you have been talking about this morning. Conciliate diversity and unity and acceptance and dignity and cultural, of course, mixture and willing to understand and accept that diversity is a richness. Merci, merci à nous.
I thank our youth who really have shown that there is this enthusiasm, this keenness, and the willingness of our youth to express themselves and to say that there is something else, and you're really fully right, that there is something else, something different from what we see on TV every day. This footage on hatred, on wars, on conflicts, yes, extremism is everywhere. But against this, we are fighting against this, and this is the result and the outcome of our meeting, that is the youth will make this voice heard, that this will say other words, different narratives. So I would like to thank them for what they've done, for what they are going to do through the social networks, through Facebook, to have another narrative different from the hatred narratives, from the narratives in favor of war, in favor of what poison our lives and the lives of our populations. I'm really delighted to see that the institutions recognize, they do recognize today what we have been saying in the foundations for a number of years now, meaning that we need to help our youth. But our institutions and our networks should also be helpful and should bear the spirit that gathers us. Now, as you see, with the UN resolution on the youth, this is a huge step that has been made. It is a recognition, actually. And the new partnerships that we developed, and I would like to thank here the director, Atem Atara, for his dedication and for working with the UNESCO, with the OSEC, with the European institution. This is a recognition, Mr. Prime Minister, and you are fully right to underscore it. It is extremely important. What you experienced and what you described is obviously, we can say from about Bosnia-Herzegovina, what I just said about Malta. So we do have this institutional recognition in the foundation, and we owe it to our networks. It's not always easy to work together. It's not always easy to reconcile the institutional constraints and limitations. They are there because we are an institution. But in the same time, the creativity, the vitality, and the willingness of each network to be specifically recognized, I think that our originality comes from there. That is this capacity, this ability that we have to move forward, which is not easy, to move forward and to preserve, to be enriched by the innovativity of our networks, as especially the peculiarities of our networks, and to work together, because we are a foundation. We are a foundation that is supported by states, by European institutions. We need to abide by the rules, of course, that make it possible for us to live and to exist. So thank you again. I thank our networks to maintain this foundation spirit, this openness spirit, this rejection of backwardness, of we do not want any wall, any barrier, any barbed wires. We do not want this. What we want is to continue to share, to exchange ideas, to meet, because without change, exchanges, without mobility, there can't be any common spirit, any common work. So humbly, in our institution, we are trying to do our part through translating our works from Arabic to the European languages, and we are encouraging the creation of this fund to encourage the translators and translation, and we are organizing the Euro-Mediterranean Voices program, which is an essential program. We are also moving forward to the Erasmus of Association, and in the meanwhile, we need to maybe have a passport for talents, of talents, of entrepreneurs, creators, artists, sportsmen from both shores of the Mediterranean. And I believe, as you said, dear madam and dear friend, we do need the foundation and all the members of the foundation to weigh on the international and European institutions as well as the governments to have a comprehensive approach of these issues, otherwise we can't make it. We need, I believe that we need as a foundation, because we are gather the 42 countries of the Mediterranean, we can have create a bridge with Africa, because we see that the refugees issue is not about those fleeing wars and massacres only. And this is why we as Europeans receive people, as I say, to the officials, French officials. We have political forces that refuse to host and to receive refugees, whereas if we were in the situation of Lebanon, if we compare the population, it's 20 million refugees that we can host, that we can receive. Therefore, I think that the Annaline Foundation is quite small in comparison to this huge international stakes. But we represent, and you represent, our networks, our 5,000 associations. You do represent the beating heart of this spirit of the Annaline Foundation that rejects and refuses violence, that rejects extremism, and beyond this rejection would bear a positive spirit to create bridges and links among peoples and populations. Thank you for everything, and thanks to all of you.
Alors, à la fin de ce débat,
well, as we come to the close of this debate, very rapidly, and something which is closely linked to what we have been discussing, Madam the Chairperson said that the youth can bear everywhere these words, this spirit against extremism, this idea that there are many other narratives than the narrative of violence. We've been working a lot on this in the Francophonie, and we've launched, our Secretary General has launched, or launched in last March, an initiative called Vivre Ensemble, that we will present, of which we will present a short video. It gathers 3,200,000 internet users in French and in other languages, and even in Arabic. 30% of the contributions are in Arabic. It is a dialogue space and an action, a space for action. That is, the youth present projects in order to create links and to further the intercultural and interreligious dialogue. We have made an appeal through based on testimony from Dakar, Marseille, Casablanca, and the answer you will see it very soon. The Vivre Ensemble is a platform, www.vivreensemble.com, and all the youth can post projects that some of which will be financed, and we are elaborating or developing a platform for financing. And here again, we're making an appeal. bill for partnership, because the vivre ensemble, or living together, is something that we should build together through partnerships, win-win partnerships, as I said earlier on. I know time is of the essence. I won't be very long, and let me just show you this urban poetry, slam, rap, hip hop, all these young people that say how we can live together in a better way. Thank you.
Ensemble, j'ai soif de liberté, mélancolie d'un lieu où je n'ai jamais mis les pieds, alors je crée, toujours en quête de raison, souvent de se le dire et de partir sans raison.
Être libre ensemble, ça veut dire se respecter les uns les autres, respecter les différences et s'entendre sur ce qui nous unit.
Pouvoir s'exprimer, parler, dire les choses à l'autre, dans la vérité.
C'est la possibilité de créer des choses et de les créer avec justement l'aide de personnes complètement différentes.
C'est la réconciliation des cultures et la réconciliation des peuples. En un mot, c'est tout ça.
J'imagine la planète comme une grande table, couscous burger, pizza boboon, jambon mafé. Et je voudrais pas avoir ce repas finir en sang, alors passe-moi le sel car c'est ça vivre ensemble.
Vivre libre et partager demain ensemble, faire un bout de chemin ou finir avec les deux mains ensemble. C'est résister quand le côté obscur devient tentant, oublier de faire des rimes pour dire qu'ici je vis en paix.
Comme Luther King et Rosa Parks, je rêve d'un monde meilleur. Black, blanc, beurre, peu importe la couleur. La paix c'est pas un rêve, tu peux demander à Gandhi. Enfant d'humanité, j'ai vu la paix grandir.
Mais dans la main pour construire un meilleur quotidien, acceptons nos différences et tissons des liens. Chaque mot, chaque voix, chaque mouvement exprime que sans les autres, ça ne sert à rien.
Acrobates en pyramide humaine ensemble, trouver l'équilibre, se tenir les coudes, sinon tout s'écroule et on bascule dans le vide.
Aujourd'hui, le problème, c'est qu'il y a des frontières, c'est que les gens ne se parlent pas assez, communiquent pas assez entre eux.
On a tendance à trop écouter le discours politique et médiatique qui parle seulement des choses qui ne vont pas.
Beaucoup de gens pensent être supérieurs aux autres, alors que ce n'est pas le cas.
Certains vivent encore au siècle dernier. Le monde est complètement métissé et les mélanges sont la règle.
On a la force et la fougue de la jeunesse. Que signifie la connaissance sans la sagesse? Qui peut me dire où ira l'humanité sans le souffle de la vraie liberté?
J'ai vu la lumière avec un prisme, les couleurs n'ont qu'une source, entre nous ce lien intime, l'unité fait le tout. On change rien avec un disque ou un discours bien pensant qui me disait quitte à mourir seul, plutôt vivre ensemble.
Dans mon quartier c'est le souk, c'est zouk, c'est raillé sous pouce, on se pousse tous, on se tape et on se retrouve devant un couscous. Barbès c'est pas le 16, c'est le quartier assaisonné, et si tu connais pas c'est que t'as pas assaisonné. Viens tard le soir t'asseoir avec moi au café. Après on ira chez Fatou manger un mafé. Ici ne dis pas qu'on a comme des drôles de manie. Enfants d'Africains, d'Algérie jusqu'au Mali.
Dans ce monde on est un moyen merveilleux. Je suis pourtant si malheureux. Que je dois faire et où je dois aller pour connaître enfin un lieu de gaieté.
Pour s'en sortir, je pense qu'il faut qu'on vive, qu'on pense aux autres.
Il faut abattre des murs et construire des ponts.
Se mettre autour d'une table et parler.
Mettre de côté toutes les idées reçues.
Mettre l'ego à côté. Faut pas être beaucoup très égoïste, en fait.
Il faut se détendre. Unité, unité, plus qu'une idée. Vibrer ensemble, c'est ce qui fait vivre l'univers. Libérer ensemble, accepter nos différences. C'est ça le message pour l'humanité. C'est ça le challenge, à la science.
On va militer, interdiction de s'asseoir. Afin de former un bloc indivisible, l'unité devrait être obligatoire, comme le port du slip de bain à la piscine.
Regarde bien, on n'est jamais seul. Check les éléments autour de toi, tu n'es jamais seul, non. Il faut du blanc, du noir, un peu de tout. Vivre bon, tout sans les autres, on n'est rien du tout.
Nique le fanatisme, aujourd'hui ça va vite. Si on reste unis, on reste libre, ce sont juste des parasites. Je me fous de ta couleur favorite, mais je fraternise. Même si pour moi t'es translucide, si t'as pas de matière grise.
Facile de s'en mêler les cordes qu'en puisant à la même source. 8 milliards de voisins pour 1000 milliards de conflits. Libre ensemble, se voir et s'écouter, s'entendre et se comprendre.
Liberté, égalité, fraternité, égalité. Liberté de penser, libre pour circuler. Peace, love, unity, positive vibration. Liberté pour tous, question de dignité.
Ensemble on peut soulever des montagnes à ce qu'il paraît. On est tous pareils du simple fait qu'on va tous disparaître. Viens, photo que je te montre une image de 7 milliards de personnes en train de se taper des barres.
Moi ce que j'aime c'est le cinéma.
J'aime les gens.
Mes amis, ma famille, mes parents.
J'aime profiter de la vie.
J'aime le sport.
Les études.
La jeunesse, la joie de vivre.
Et tout ça, j'ai envie de le partager avec toi.
Yeah. Mix
des rimes ensemble pour que le verbe germe. Illumine l'ensemble, c'est une terre vierge. Vivre libre ensemble, c'est le même thème. Si petite soit-elle, c'est la même graine.
C'est en acceptant l'autre qu'on s'enrichit. J'aime pas ta froideur, ici c'est pas la Russie. Chaleur, chaleur, faut vivre ensemble. Acceptons nos différences, il est temps qu'on se rassemble.
Entre le marteau et l'enclume, les fachos et les enflures. Vivre ensemble, entre gens sûrs, j'en suis. Par ces temps durs, c'est tendu, on endure. Mais chandu, love quand même, on a la dent dure.
En tant que Syrien, français, souvent je retiens mes larmes. Je sais qu'il est trop tard le jour où tu prends les armes. Garde le sourire, même doublement le cœur brisé. On se doit de l'ouvrir, le silence est le pire meurtrier.
Brisons les chaînes, ignorons la haine, vivons l'indépendance et non la dépendance. Pour vivre la liberté, nous devons vivre ensemble. Partager, discuter, c'est ça, libre ensemble.
Demain, on sera libre ensemble parce que je vais créer une danse interplanétaire qui fera un truc comme ça.
Demain, on sera libre ensemble parce que maintenant, on s'en fout des nationalités, on s'en fout des origines.
On va faire l'effort de s'unir, on va faire l'effort d'aller vers l'autre.
On acceptera les idées de chacun et on ne mettra pas de barrières aux différentes cultures autour de nous.
On est nés libres.
Et on doit rester libre et on doit mourir libre.
Quand on donne une énergie positive, c'est-à-dire quand on commence avant tout par sourire aux gens, on va recevoir l'émotion de la même qualité.
Prendre les préjugés et les foutre dans une poubelle recyclable. Et ces préjugés vont être recyclés dans cette poubelle recyclable qui va recycler du bonheur et beaucoup d'amour.
Il faut rester positif, surtout croire à l'avenir. Nous sommes ensemble, construisons un monde meilleur pour demain, pour nos enfants et leurs enfants.
Vivre ensemble, vivre ensemble, vivre ensemble.
De Dakar à Bruxelles, de Montréal à Paris, de Casa à Ouaga, de Lomé à Hanoï, de Jacmel à Kinshasa, nous sommes sur les 5 continents et chaque parole, chaque mot compte. Dire ce qui nous lie ensemble, dire notre fureur de vivre libre ensemble. Alors votre voix compte. Rejoignez-nous sur notre plateforme, on veut vous entendre.